Hello everyone, welcome to ANAT AV. Today we will be taking a look at the femur. The femur or thigh bone is the long bone of the thigh. It is the longest, heaviest, and strongest bone of the body. Like any other typical long bone, it has an upper end, which leads into a shaft, and a lower end. The upper end has two trochanters, and the lower end has two femoral condyles.
Side determination. To determine the side of the bone, we must consider the following features. First, the upper end bears a rounded head, whereas the lower end is widely expanded to form two large condyles. Second, the femoral head is directed medially. Third, the lesser trochanter is posterior and the cylindrical shaft is convex forwards. Thus, we can decide whether this is the left or the right femur. In this case, it is the right femur. In anatomical position, first, the rounded head is directed medially upwards and slightly forwards. Second, the shaft is directed obliquely downwards and medially, so that the lower surface of the two condyles of the femur lie in the same horizontal plane. Therefore, the lower end of the femur can be placed on a flat horizontal surface, such as a table, to orient the bone.
The upper end. The upper end of the femur includes the following parts. The head. The head is two-thirds of a sphere. It is directed upwards, medially, and slightly forwards. It articulates with the acetabulum to form the hip joint. A roughened pit is situated just below and behind the center of the head. This pit is called the fovea. The neck. The neck is long. It connects the head with the shaft. The anterior surface of the neck is entirely intracapsular. It meets the shaft at the intertrochanteric line. The posterior surface meets the shaft at the intertrochanteric crest. Only a little more than its medial half is intracapsular. Greater and lesser trochanters are located at the junction of the shaft and the neck. The greater trochanter. This is the large quadrangular prominence located at the upper part of the junction of the neck with the shaft, and it projects upwards. The lesser trochanter. The lesser trochanter is a conical eminence directed posteromedially from the junction of the posteroinferior part of the neck with the shaft. The intertrochanteric line. Anteriorly, the intertrochanteric line runs between the greater and lesser trochanters at the junction between neck and shaft. It is a prominent, roughened ridge which is continuous below with the spiral line. The intertrochanteric crest. Posteriorly, the intertrochanteric crest runs between the trochanters at the junction between neck and shaft. It is a smooth, rounded ridge. A rounded elevation is present a little above the middle of the crest, and it is called the quadrate tubercle.
The shaft. It is cylindrical in shape. It is narrowest in the middle and is more expanded inferiorly than superiorly. It is convex forwards and is directed obliquely downwards and medially. The upper ends of two femora are separated by the width of the pelvis and their lower ends are close together. in the middle one-third. The shaft has a posterior border in the form of a broad roughened ridge called the linea aspera, the rough line. The linea aspera has a distinct medial and lateral lips. In the upper one-third of the shaft, the two lips of the linea aspera diverge. Intertrochanteric line continues as a spiral line to the medial lip of linea aspera. Gluteal tuberosity is present posteriorly on the lateral part of the shaft, just below greater trochanter. It continues to the lateral lip of linea aspera. In the lower one-third of the shaft, the two lips of the linea aspera diverge as supracondylar lines, medial and lateral, to enclose an additional popliteal surface. Supracondylar lines lead to the condyles.
The lower end of the femur is widely expanded to form two large condyles, one medial and one lateral. Anteriorly, the two condyles are united in line with the front of the shaft. Posteriorly, they project backwards and are separated by a deep gap termed the intercondylar fossa or the intercondylar notch. This notch separates the lower and posterior parts of the two condyles. It is limited anteriorly by the patella. The lateral condyle. The lateral condyle projects more forwards than the medial. It is stouter and stronger. The lateral aspect presents a prominence called the lateral epicondyle and the popliteal groove. The medial condyle. This condyle is convex medially. The most prominent point on it is called the medial epicondyle. Posterior superior to the epicondyle, there is a projection, the adductor tubercle, at the distal end of the medial supracondylar line. The epiphyseal line for the lower end of the femur passes through it. The muscle and ligamentous attachments of the femur are as follows. Clinical relevance. The neck shaft angle. The neck makes an angle with the shaft. The neck shaft angle is about 135 degrees in adults. It is less in females due to the presence of a wider pelvis. The angle facilitates movements of the hip joint. The angle subtended by the femoral neck to the shaft may be decreased, producing a coxavara deformity. This may result from adduction fractures, slipped femoral epiphysis, or bone softening diseases. Coxavalga, in which the angle is increased, is much rarer, but occurs in impacted abduction fractures. In children, however, the normal angle between the neck and the shaft is approximately 160 degrees. There's a curious age pattern of hip injuries. Children may sustain green stick fractures of the femoral neck. Schoolboys may displace the epiphysis of the femoral head. In adult life, the hip dislocates. And in old age, fracture of the neck of the femur again becomes the usual lesion.
Blood supply of head of femur. The head of the femur has three arterial supplies. First, the retinacular arteries. Second, vessels traveling up from diaphysis. From the diaphyseal artery, which is a branch of the second perforating branch of profunda femoris. Third, artery in the ligamentum teres capitis. Although its contribution is negligible in adults, it is the main blood supply to the femoral head in children when the femoral head is separated from the neck by the cartilage of the epiphyseal line. Blood supply of the head of the femur is of importance in femoral neck fractures. Fractures of the proximal part of femur. The upper end of the femur is a common site for fracture in the elderly. The neck may break immediately beneath the head, subcapital, near its midpoint, cervical, or adjacent to the trochanters, basal. Or the fracture line may pass between, along, or just below the trochanter, pertrochanteric, or intertrochanteric. Fractures of the femoral neck will interrupt completely the blood supply from the diaphysis and, should the retinacular also be torn, avascular necrosis of the head will be inevitable. The nearer the fracture to the femoral head, the more tenuous the retinacular blood supply and more likely it is to be disrupted. Avascular necrosis of the femoral head in children is seen in Perthes disease and in severe slip femoral epiphysis, both resulting from thrombosis of the artery of the ligamentum teres. In contrast, pertrochanteric fractures being outside the joint capsule leave the retinacular arteries undisrupted. Avascular necrosis, therefore, does not follow such injuries. Shenton's line. It is an imaginary curved line drawn along the inferior border of the superior pubic ramus or superior border of the obturator foramen and along the inferomedial border of the neck of the femur. In X-ray films, it should be continuous and smooth. This line gets disrupted in neck fracture and hip dislocation. Mid-shaft fractures. Fractures of the femoral shaft are accompanied by considerable shortening as a result of the longitudinal contraction of the extremely strong surrounding muscles. The proximal segment is flexed by iliacus and psoas and abducted by gluteus medius and minimus, whereas the distal segment is pulled medially by the adductor muscles. Fracture of the distal shaft of femur. Fractures of the lower end of the shaft immediately above the condyles are relatively rare. Fortunately so, because they can be extremely difficult to treat since the small distal fragment is tilted backwards by gastrocnemius, the only muscle which is attached to it. The sharp proximal edge of the distal fragment may also tear the popliteal artery, which lies directly behind it.
That brings to an end this video on the anatomy of the femur. If you enjoyed this video and found it helpful, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Please share this with your friends and anyone interested in the study of anatomy. Thank you for watching ANAT AV.